racing is something. My dad's friends would always say, when's that boy going to get that stuff out of his system? You know, the bottom line is that there are things that are in you that fill you up, that give you energy, that restore you, that you don't ever want to get out of your system. And I asked my dad to take me to one motocross race so he could see what it was. And I had never been to one, but I had looked at a lot of magazines. I said, I wanted to do that. And he said, well, there's no way you're going to do this. This is too dangerous. That drive and that competitive nature and the desire to race was in me, and I don't know where it came from. We went to Watkins Glen, New York to some sports car races and Formula One races. I was totally smitten by what the sound and the smell and the equipment and the sophistication, the technology, the drivers.
An auto race is more than cars running in circles. From the first beautiful entertainer to the last tired driver, it's a special event like nothing else in all of sports.
Here in Richmond, Virginia, NASCAR used to come and race one race a year. Dad used to take us out there.
Fourth turn, Ray Williams, J.D. McDuffie, and Henley Gray mangle each other's sheet metal.
Richard Petty's making an unscheduled pit stop after running some ragged laps.
I told my parents I really wanted to try to do professional stock car racing. So I started that when I got out of college.
Gentlemen, it's time to get your cars through inspection and on the pit road.
For the Dixie Cup 200 late model sportsman race, and again tomorrow at 1 o'clock.
What I believed was that I don't want to be a person that looks back on their life and said, I wish I had.
Number three. Oh, and we have trouble on the straightaway once again, and Charlie Luck is involved, so is David Pearson and Tommy Ellis. Pearson is out of his car, there is Tommy Ellis, he is out of his car, and Charlie Luck is also okay apparently, so no injuries in this accident.
Racing is extraordinarily expensive, and there was no way I could do it without the support of our family company, Luck Stone. Fortunately, a lot of our customers were NASCAR fans.
On January 20th, 1986, with over 100 media representatives and guests in attendance, Advance Auto Parts announced a major new marketing effort, a co-sponsorship agreement to form the Advance Auto Parts Luck Stone Racing Team, with Charlie Luck as driver and Sam Ard as car builder and crew chief.
In number nine is running the same motor with which he qualified at 205 miles an hour. Most people thought that was a hand grenade.
I was competing against a lot of people who came from racing. We didn't know anything as a family about racing. We had to go find the best talent we could, and I would say learn from bottom up.
This is going to be a great race from Daytona. The pace car is off. The green flag waves are underway.
Over time, the speed, you get used to it. And it really becomes this fine art of trying to drive the car on the limit of the grip of the tire.
He loved racing so much. I reminded him of racing. My family was still in racing. My father was still racing, my brother. We dated for a couple years, and then that was when we were talking about marriage and about I didn't want to marry a race car driver, and I didn't want to raise my children that way. So we broke up.
The last season, which was 1986 for me, I made the decision. There was no pressure from my parents or from people at the company to make that my last season. I always say that life is about choices. And we all have millions of choices we make over the course of our life. Who your friends are, where you work, who your spouse is, do you have faith, how you handle your money, what hobbies do you have, who do you hang around? I mean, all of these things impact who you become.
Margaret was in, I think, her junior year at UNC. Charlie came to me and he said, "We've raised our children. They're pretty much out and on their own. Can I go back racing?"
Charlie called me up. They said, "Hey, you know, I was at this Formula One race and I saw these Porsche 911s racing and it looked like a blast. And, you know, I want to start driving again." We took him to Road Atlanta to his first test. He tested for about 6 hours and he started making some pretty big mistakes. I said, "You know, let's call it a day." And it was like 3 o'clock in the afternoon and he pulled in and I went up to him. I was waiting for him to jump out and he just kept sitting there and I opened the door and he was crying. He was so happy.
Looking to try and make a move on Charlie Luck, but Charlie, he's been out of motorsports for 20 years prior to this year. He did some what was then NASCAR Busch Series competition 20-odd years ago, did motocross before that, but he's back in the groove now.
Oh, and he's loving it. Big smile on his face every time we see him.
I came home from every race and every test on cloud nine, and even if we wrecked, I was like, so what? We wrecked, we learned a bunch. It was so challenging and so fun, it just kept getting better.
How about the fight in Pro-Am coming in to the anti-penultimate race?
Well, it's so tight. We've got three teams separated by a mere 4 points, so anything can happen here. Very much anyone's task right now. You got the Porsche team, Wright Motorsports, leading that Pro-Am category right now.
You know, so much focus is on the driver. But frankly, races are often won or lost in the race shop. How it's prepared, how it's set up, all the thousands and thousands of details that have to be exactly right is critical. So the caliber of people you have on the team, their attention to detail, has everything to do with what the driver has to work with.
Charlie became one of our clients, and from day one, I became his coach. What we started doing 6 or something years ago, we're still doing the same thing. We're only at a very different level now.
We raced together in the SRO GT World Challenge, which requires a pro and an amateur to race together. And Jan obviously is a pro and I'm the amateur. John Wright really cautioned us to make sure that we had talked about it in depth, because he said, "I don't want to see racing be a wedge in your relationship."
You're sharing the season with your father-in-law. When you think of the memories that have been made this year between you guys, what stood out the most?
It's been such a long process. This is year 5 or 6 that we've been together and haven't been there from the very beginning, and then to be here today and fighting for the championship is incredible.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Good, Charlie. Start it up.
Lights off on the safety car. The field into 2x2 alignment.
Lights out. We're going green this time, Charlie. Are you ready?
I'm ready. I'm ready.
And as the field enters the VP acceleration zone, Tom Hensing, the flagman, in that starter stand, waiting to give the green, and he does. We're racing at Sebring in a big spin in the back of the pack. It's Erin Goble. She's gone around and appeared to make contact with the inside wall. Caught up in it as well. The fight is on.
Four course yellow, car one.
We got a four course yellow, Charlie. Four course yellow, we got a car on the left side of the front straight.
43
If you make a mistake when you have a driver partner, then that means you're denying him the option to contribute.
This car has accelerated away, and we're about to go back to green.
I definitely feel more pressure under a two-driver format than a single-driver format.
It's down
into
turn one. The car's fanning out. Here comes Harrison, looking to make a move for the lead in Pro-Am.
Still there, then
Corvette. Albo's there down to the brake zone for Christensen's corner. This is tight. She just clears him.
Big move for Ashton Harrison to take the top spot away. Battle rages on for the lead in Pro-Am. It's Ashton Harrison leading the way. Charlie Luck, who held the top spot momentarily, gave it up. First couple of laps of this race, he runs in second. We're on board with Charlie now. You can see out the back that George Kurtz is at the pole. Luck goes around.
Hold the brake, Corbett. You okay?
It certainly cost Charlie a great deal of time. You can see the right team scrambling up on top of their box.
The mind wants you to regrind on a mistake and go, damn, I made that mistake, and why did I make it? And in the meantime, the next corner is looking at you.
All right, Charlie, we're gonna pitch this lap. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, right ahead, line up the sign.
What I love most about it, I mean, for me, that's easy. It's the feeling of achieving something great. We've all been doing this for a very long time, so a win is great. A big win, that's when you get that feeling.
You're 9.5 seconds to the car in front. Call it Brian.
He's a super intense perfectionist. He's able to do things with a race car that are kind of near superhuman.
Yeah, Halen. He is catching these guys. This is huge in the championship.
There's a lot of talk about putting yourself or the car on the limit. Movies are you hear other people talking about it. It sounds maybe a little bit more magical, but in reality it all comes down to your four tires. That's what's keeping you on the road.
We drop back here, three-way battle, and here comes Halen taking a peek up the inside of Brown. Oh, that was awfully tight between the two of them. That might have been the best chance that he was gonna get, and he gave it a run.
That's the definition of putting a car on the limit. Now, how you get there, you can say that's maybe magic. That is what's hard to do.
Mario Farnbacher, Ashton Harrison, and Racer's Edge win on home soil here in the state of Florida. Second place to Colin Brown, George Kurtz, and Riley Motorsports, while Wright comes home third.
I want to go back to the overtake on Charlie Luck on that restart. How did you plan that one out for yourself?
I had a really great restart coming out of 17, and I just stuck behind him and took the position as soon as I saw the opportunity. He did fight me for it, and I would have done the same, so I don't blame him for that. But, you know, he made me work for it just as much as any of the other competitors would.
Racing in Europe is different than what it is here. Do I like racing here in the US better? Absolutely, especially today. But as far as learning the skills and the trade, Europe is the place to be. When you grow up in Europe, F1 is the top. So naturally, as a kid, when you're karting, you know that the good drivers come out of karting and they go into cars and then they end up in F1.
Tony Kart machines in this massive field. 34 starters.
Everybody in Belgium thought at the time like that I was going to be the next Belgian guy to reach F1.
The two championship contenders, nose to tail on the track. 133 in amongst them there. Jan Halen of Belgium picking up places left, right and center now.
It's crazy to think back and how it really got started because I don't come from a racing family. We started going to Genk with my buddy. Then, of course, I started asking my dad if I could have a go-kart. My biggest break in my career is when I got approached by a guy named Paul Lemmens. He was the guy that everybody looked up to. A lot of drivers that had gone to F1 had gone through his team, and people in F1, managers, team owners, they would reach out to people like Paul to see who the next talent was.
Jan Halen, I'm still trying to find his grid position. He was so far back down the order.
My name was suggested to them, but at the time, you know, the nationality of that driver also was a factor. When I was young, that was definitely a frustration to know that I could do the same job and that I didn't get that shot.
So Jan Halen, victory, the checkered flag. And what a margin of victory it was indeed.
The task begins anew here at Sebring, closing in on the start of the final 90-minute race of the season, with just the Indianapolis 8 hours looming in 2 weeks' time. Closing in on the start of the race and high drama already, Calvin. You can see hands on the head of Ashton Harrison because her Acura NSX GT3 Evo, that car that won the Pro-Am class yesterday in the pits with some kind of mechanical drama. The field in the VP acceleration zone and the little green flag flies.
These top pros, they're top draw talent for sure here in this championship.
It's easy to explain to someone where to brake or where to turn in or how to accelerate, but you can teach them how to feel the car.
He can take that Porsche and he gets to the inside of Sellers. What a move! Off the brake pedal, just carried that momentum into the corner and made the car stick.
Charlie Luck getting ready himself. Big stint for him with the championship in mind. Keep in mind, he had that little miscue in his stint yesterday. That might have cost them a chance at the win.
Yeah, Jan Halen was very much on the rebound after that spin by Charlie, but Charlie's been up on the wheel. It's just that one mistake, really. His pace has been good here.
Every driver knows deep inside whether they have delivered their best performance, regardless of what place they finish.
On board, Charlie Luck. He has run down Justin Weatherill. That is the class leader just out the windshield.
It's being in flow. It's being in the zone. You are in this place where you're feeling the car, and the tires are like your hands. And you're feeling the grip, and you are pushing the car to the just right amount.
Corner, looking to make the long way work. Luck, though, he's got momentum of his own. Looking to the inside for the class lead in Pro-Am. Charlie Luck to the points.
You do extraordinary things when you're in that zone. And those are the highest probability of delivering a victory.
Nice job, Charlie. That is the checkered flag.
Wright Motorsports needed a big result for the championship. They got one. Charlie Luck, Jan Halen, and Wright win the Pro-Am class.
P1, baby, P1.
Cars, yes, yes, yes! After yesterday, yes, yes!
awesome, awesome driving, Charlie. That's the best I've seen you drive all year. Great work.
After the miscue yesterday, Charlie, was this one of your most impressive drives of your career?
Oh my gosh, we had to get redemption for yesterday. Jan drove his tail off and took us 9 seconds deficit up to third. And geez. So today I sat in the car and I think we were P1 or P2. And I said, this is everything you got, buddy. Everything you got right now. So it was spot on. We were magical today. Magical.
When I think about my relationship with Jan, he's taught me a tremendous amount. And I hope that I have taught him a lot. As you grow older, I would say you have more decades of life to share. I try to share as much of that as I can, as much of that that Jan wants to hear, is interested in, and particularly the things that are appropriate to the stage in life that he's in.
When I first started racing, there was not the thought nor the responsibility of having a family. What we do is extremely difficult as far as, you know, being in racing and making a living. And if you're not 1,000% committed, it's just not going to work out. The way I go about racing today versus even as little as 5 years ago is different. I've got Margaret here at home, and so now after every race, you know, you try to get home as fast as you can.
Double points this weekend. Normally it's 25 for a win, instead it's 50. Normally 18 for second, instead it's 36. That's a pretty big delta, and that could make a huge impact in that Pro-Am Championship battle that is coming down to the wire.
Sometimes I look at myself and I say, oh my gosh, I'm living my mother's life. She was, you know, watching my dad race when they were older. You know, now I'm watching Charlie, and we're older, at an older stage in our life. And now I'm thinking, Margaret, she's a part of this club.
Charlie, have fun, man.
All right, brother.
Have fun. It'll be good.
Of course, yeah.
Yes, me too, man. Super excited. Yes.
Mindset was no different from any other race. We were there to try and win the race, and with that, win the championship.
At Indianapolis, a bit of a frantic start, but the race is on.
In an endurance race, the strategy is, hey, let's survive the first 90% of the race, and then in that last 10%, we're going to go racing hard.
Two laps, Celia. Two laps to pit will be a driver change stop.
Copy, we're looking.
Power steering.
Copy, power steering. We're working on a solution, Jan. We're working on a solution. Do the best you can till we have one.
Yeah, I can only do this for a few more laps. Ripping my arms off.
I was listening to the radio, and the power steering started locking up.
Copy, pit, stay calm, pit.
tried the obvious initially, but then you just eliminate the obvious. You know you have to go into it deep and take it to the garage.
Check valve in the line blew up, okay, so we tried to flush the line, got a lot of the bits out of it, so unless there's a piece stuck inside the port in the rack, we should be okay, okay, but if there's a piece stuck in there, then it's a big job to fix.
Copy, understood, thank you, Johnny.
Yeah, copy that, we'll just do the best we can here.
We had a chance to win the championship if some of the other cars we competed against had a little bit of trouble. And that didn't end up happening.
It's racing, it's not called winning. Like, man, you can go a long time without winning a race, but you're doing the same thing, you know, like you're working just as hard the weekends that you're not winning than the weekends that you are winning. It takes a certain someone to do this week in, week out, and to stay motivated and to want to do this to perfection every day, all day, knowing that most of those days the result is not going to be what we ultimately hope for.
Wright Motorsports car is back out, but well down the order, 10th in class.
Look how many laps Ian Haylen is down now. 17 laps to the leader and 15 laps to the 93 car.
Would I have wanted to win the championship? Of course we would have. Like, of course. But we didn't. And just because we didn't win the championship, that does not mean that the year was a failure. We grew so much as a team and as people, and we also really had a lot of fun. And we really enjoyed each other's company. And I believe it's important to hold on to the strong, positive moments in life and not hold on too tightly to the disappointments.
Sorry, Mom. Wasn't our day today, you know?
Congratulations, buddy. We earned second in the championship. There's only one team that beat us. So, thank you. Thank you, thank you. Absolutely. Love the year. So cool. Incredible. You don't forget these moments.
How many people that are sports car advocates would like to be in our shoes? So, hello, when we're having a tough day, let's get real. We are incredibly fortunate.